now, as gunshots echo across the windswept, snow-covered reaches of the wild Northwest, the challenge of the Yukon. It's Yukon King, swiftest and strongest lead dog of the Northwest, blazing the trail for Sergeant Preston of the Northwest Mounted Police in his relentless pursuit of lawbreakers.
On King, on, Husky!
Gold, gold discovered in the Yukon, a stampede to the Klondike in the wild race for riches, back to the days of the gold rush, bringing you the adventures of Sergeant Preston and his wonder dog Yukon King as they meet the challenge of the Yukon. Adams and Bert Hogan were contemplating the problem of lifting a very large stone which had been set deeply into the rugged ground when they heard the approach of nearby footsteps. Turning quickly, they saw a man in the winter uniform of the Northwest Mounted Police. A dog, one of the most magnificent they'd ever seen, was at his side.
Hey, Mounty.
Yeah. Good thing you didn't catch us moving this rock.
Uh-huh. You better let me do the talking, Bert, just in case.
Go ahead.
Morning, Mounty.
Good morning, men. Prospecting?
Yeah, that's our trade.
Only we're not having much luck at it. Don't know any good mines just waiting to be found, do you, Sergeant?
Found or jumped?
Jumped.
What do you mean by that?
That boulder you've been looking at for the past 10 minutes? It's a claim marker. You weren't figuring on moving it, were you?
Us? Oh, of course not. We're not claim jumpers.
And I don't like to be accused of being one either.
Neither do I.
Nobody's accused you. I only asked you a question.
Well, you got our answer. We're not claim jumpers.
And you're wasting your time. This is a dead man's claim, and it's recorded in Dawson. I recorded it myself for his widow. Just thought I'd tell you. Come on, King.
As the sergeant turned on his heels and walked away, followed by the great dog King, the two men watched him in silence until he disappeared in the thick scrub timber.
You know who that is, Bert?
Never laid eyes on him before,
and neither did I. But I know who he is, and I don't want to mix with him and that dog.
That dog? Hey, he called it King.
Yeah, that's Sergeant Preston. There's not but one dog in the whole Yukon like that, and Preston owns him. Come on, Bert, let's move on.
Pokey, what are you going
to
do?
We'll go back to Halfway and tell Big Steve Fellows that if he wants his claim, he'll have to buy it. It can't be jumped.
It was 3 days later when Big Steve Billows, gambler, mining wildcatter, and claim speculator, heard the news. He nodded quietly, made plans, and then called on Kate Watson, keeper of the tavern in the trailside community of Halfway. He found her busily engaged in putting up freshly ironed curtains in the small dining room.
Sit down, Big Steve. I'll be through putting up these curtains in a minute.
Well, thanks, Kate. Take your time.
What took you around this early in the morning, Steve?
Wanted to talk over a little business proposition.
About what?
Well, before your husband died, didn't he stake out a claim somewhere up in the Salt Shaker Range?
Why, yes, he did. Why?
I thought I heard you say something about it at the time. You want to sell it, Kate?
Somebody make a strike up there?
Not that I've heard of.
Then why do you want to buy my claim?
Well, you know my business. I'm a speculator. I'll gamble on anything.
If it's a sure bet, you will.
Oh, now, Kate, you'd be surprised how many claims I've bought that have never paid off a dime. As far as I know, that claim of yours isn't worth the paper it's recorded on. Strictly a gamble with me. In fact, I might never put a pick into the ground unless somebody should strike it rich up that way.
Well, I won't argue the point with you, Steve, but at the moment, my claim's not for sale.
Oh, I thought you didn't like it up here. I thought you wanted to go back to the States.
Oh, I did. I've often thought of selling out my tavern and going back to Nebraska. And I might do it later on. Cold depends.
What do you mean?
See those nice curtains I just put up?
Yeah. Hey, they're real pretty, Kate. What about them?
Well, somebody's coming, Steve. Somebody I haven't seen in 6 years. Somebody I love more than anything on earth.
Who?
My son, Jimmy. He should be getting to Dawson in the next couple of days.
I didn't know you had a son, Kate.
Yes, and if it hadn't been for Jimmy, I'd have gone back to the States a long time ago.
Where's he been?
We left him with my sister in Nebraska when Walter and I came up here 6 years ago. He was quite young, and we wanted him to finish his schooling. Now he's finished, and he's coming here. I just kept the tavern going, so there's a business for him to step into, if he likes.
Well, what if he doesn't like it?
Then I'll be glad to sell out and return to the States with him.
Sell out this tavern as well as your claim, huh?
I wouldn't sell one without the other.
Well, I'm only interested in the gold claim.
If I sell out, Steve, it's all or nothing. I figure I should get $10,000 for this tavern.
That's a lot of money.
That's the price, and I'll throw the gold claim in. That is, if I sell.
Kate, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll meet your price.
But I'm not sure. It all depends on how my boy feels.
Sure, sure, that's understood. I'll just draw up a little agreement, so if you do decide to sell, you'll sell to me. It'll be binding on me, but you don't have to sell unless you want to.
As long as it's not binding on me, I don't see where I can lose anything.
All right, Kate. I'll get the agreement drawn up right away and bring it around for you to sign before noon.
There's no rush, Steve. Take your time.
Oh, by the way, Kate, have you seen that Monty with the big dog recently?
You mean Sergeant Preston and Kate?
Yeah.
They were through here about a week ago. They brought the letter from Jimmy.
Oh, you haven't seen him since then?
No, why?
Oh, nothing in particular. I just hadn't seen Preston a long spell myself. Well, so long, Kate. I'll be back for noon.
So long, Steve.
In the meantime, Big Steve's henchmen were waiting for the return of the man who gave them their orders.
Steve didn't waste time getting over to see Kate Watson after what we told him, eh, Bert?
He sure didn't. Steve's like that. You know, Pokey, I'd give a lot to know what that Mountie was doing up there in Salt Shaker Range.
Ah, don't let it worry you. The Mounties have regular patrols. Salt Shaker Range is in Preston's territory.
I hope you're right.
Yeah, that must be Big Steve coming back now. Something's got the dogs excited.
Yeah, it's Steve. I see him through the window. He's heading in here fast.
How'd you make out, Steve?
Okay, so far. Fine, we act fast.
Act fast? What do you mean?
We haven't much time. I didn't buy the claim.
She wouldn't sell, huh?
Not yet. But I've got an agreement. Right now, we've got a job to do. Bert.
Yes, Steve?
Get outside and round up the dogs. Get them hitched to the sled. You, Pokey.
Yeah?
Start packing grub for a trip to Dawson.
Dawson?
Yeah. You and Bert are hitting the trail for Dawson just as soon as possible.
But what in thunder are you sending us there for?
To do a job for me. I got a move on you. The weather's thickening, and I don't want you to get caught in a blizzard before you get there.
Snow, crisp and brittle, swirled through the streets of Dawson. And even hardened sourdoughs sought warmth and comfort inside taverns, dance halls, and places of amusement along the town's main thoroughfare. It was toward one of these, the Northern Lights Cafe, that Pokey Adams and Bert Hogan guided their dog sled as they entered the town, 2 days after having left Big Steve Billows at Hatfield.
Mush! I'm glad this trip's over. I don't like traveling this kind of weather.
It's not over, Bert. It's only half over if things pan out right. They'll
curl up in the snow, Pokey. Come on, let's get inside.
Easy there, easy. Now, let's get out of this weather.
Man, oh man, it's warm in here. The first thing I want is a cup of hot coffee and a big steak.
Well, you order up for both of us. Yeah. I'll go to the clerk and find out if Jimmy Watson's staying here. I'll be back, Pronto.
It took Pokey but a few moments to locate Jimmy Watson and strike up an acquaintance. He found Jimmy friendly and pleasant.
Hey, you'll have to meet my partner. That's him over there at the table. We just got in.
You mean you've been traveling in this storm?
Oh, this is just Yukon weather. It's not bad when you get used to it.
I'd have to have a very good reason before I'd get out of here tonight.
Yeah? Oh, we've got a good reason. Now, here he is, Jimmy. Bert, this is Jimmy Watson.
Well, now, Jimmy, I'm sure proud to know you.
Glad to know you, sir.
Have a chair, Jimmy. We've got to talk to you.
Oh, fine, thanks.
Did you tell him about his mother, Pokey?
Mother? What about her?
Well, Jimmy, I don't want to scare you none, but your mother sent us down here to get you. That'll explain why we're traveling in weather like this.
What's the matter? Has something happened?
Your mother took sick 2 days ago.
Oh, no.
Mighty low.
She was failing fast when we left halfway. We didn't stop but once on the way here.
Mother sick?
Dying, Jimmy.
No, don't say that.
Doc says there's only one thing that may save her.
If you get there in time, Jimmy, we've come to get you.
It's a matter of life and death.
Yes, yes, of course. That's wonderful of both of you to risk your lives in a storm like this.
Will you go with us, Jimmy?
Oh, yes, of course I'll go, but...
But what?
will we get there in this storm?
Jimmy, me and Bertie used to traveling in this stuff. It's not too bad when you dress for it. We brought along some clothing for you.
Then I'll go. When do we start?
Just as soon as me and Bert have had something to eat. Meanwhile, your ears in this bundle here.
You go get into your clothes and check out. We'll be through eating by that time.
I'll hurry.
Jimmy.
Yes, Mr. Adams?
When you check out, don't tell the clerk where you're heading.
All right. But why?
Well, he knows you're a tenderfoot. You might have the Mounties try to keep you from going.
You see, the Mounties don't like the idea of having to go find tenderfeet that get lost in snowstorms. A lot of them do.
But you don't have to worry so long as you're with us. We know the trail to halfway blindfolded.
Then in that case, I'd better not leave word for Sergeant Preston that I've gone with you.
Preston?
What do you know about him?
The last letter I had from my mother, she said for me to wait here in Dawson for Sergeant Preston. Said he'd see I got to halfway safely.
Oh, I see. Now you leave that to me. While you're getting your clothes on, I'll see a friend of his and explain how it is.
Will you do that, please?
Sure.
I know he'll expect to find me waiting here when he comes into town.
Sure, Pokey will take care of it. Now you run along and get dressed for the trip.
It won't take me long. I'll be ready by the time you're finished eating.
Well, Pokey, what do you make of that?
I don't like it, Bert. But Preston's not in town yet. We'll be gone before he gets here. And if Jimmy keeps his trap shut, Preston will never know who he left with.
That's what you think. Just look who came in the door.
Preston and his dog.
Yeah, it's him, Pokey. And if you catch the sight of us, our whole plan is blowed to kingdom come.
We'll continue our story in just a moment. And now to continue our story. Pokey Adams and Bert Hogan have succeeded in persuading young Jimmy Watson to go with them, presumably to halfway where they told him his mother was dying. However, they saw their plans endangered when Sergeant Preston and the great dog King entered the dining room of the Northern Lights Cafe in Dawson.
Yeah, that's Sergeant Preston, all right.
If he catches sight of us, it's going to be too bad, Pokey.
Yeah, there's no doubt in that. Now listen, Bert.
Yeah?
We've got to do something and do it quick. The kid will be coming back here any minute now. Preston will see him talking to us.
Preston don't know the kid?
I know that. But later on, when he inquires for Jimmy Watson, he's going to put two and two together. So we've got to get Preston out of here until we can hit the trail with Jim.
How are we doing?
I'll stay here and pull my parka high like this so he won't recognize me. Now, you sneak out the side door. Get down the street a piece and start shooting. But don't let nobody see who you are.
Okay, but I don't get the idea.
Do as I say. But keep an eye on that dog sled of ours. When you see me and Jimmy come out, get set to join us west of town. Now get going.
I hope I don't land in jail for this.
Hello, King. Boy, how are you?
Well, Sergeant, I reckon you and King could stand for a big hot supper, couldn't you?
Certainly could. If you'll order for us, I'll go wash up.
Sure thing, Sergeant.
Hey, sure. What's
that gunfight
down the street?
Let's go, boy.
Will.
Yes, Sergeant Preston.
Better hold up that supper until I look into the shooting.
Sure thing, Sarge. Go right along.
Come on, King. There's work to do.
Sergeant Preston, the great dog, quickly left the lobby of the hotel to investigate the shooting. A few moments later, Jimmy Watson entered the now deserted dining room where Pokey Adams waited.
Well, I'm ready, Mr. Adams.
So am I, Jimmy. Let's get going.
Where's Mr. Hogan?
Oh, there's some shooting going on down the street. He stepped outside to see what's up.
I thought I heard shooting.
Bert will join us outside somewhere. Come on.
All right.
After an investigation, Sergeant Preston discovered the shooting was the boisterous prank of a sourdough. Then he and the crowd returned to the Northern Lights Cafe. 2 hours later, after the Mountie had finished his meal, he stopped at the desk of the clerk who had charge of the hotel rooms.
Bill, is there a young fellow named Watson stopping here?
Well, there was, Sergeant, but he's gone now.
Gone? Gone where?
Can't say where. He checked out about the time of that shooting.
You say where he was going?
No, he didn't. And I didn't ask him. He was wearing blizzard clothing, though.
Was there someone with him?
Not when he checked his room key, there wasn't. But I saw him leave the dining room with a fella.
You don't know who it was?
No, I don't. But I recollect seeing his friend come in with another man a little earlier this evening. But the second gent wasn't with him when they went out the door.
That's strange.
Is there something wrong, Sergeant?
Well, Jimmy Watson was supposed to wait here for me. Wonder why he'd check out before I saw him.
That is strange. Come to think of it, young Watson did say when he got here he wanted to see you, Sergeant.
Did he leave any baggage?
Well, his trunk's in his room. He said he'd let me know when and where to send it.
Bill, I'd like to see that trunk.
Okay, Sergeant, I'll show it to you. Come along upstairs with me.
One thing. I want you to get Jimmy sent from his belongings, boy. We may have to go find him.
Meanwhile, Pokey Adams and Bert Hogan were on the trail with young Jimmy Watson, who was running alongside of the sled.
Come on, you Alamir! March! March!
Keep pushing him, Pokey!
Yeah, I will! March, you Alamir! March!
Mr. Adams! Oh, Mr. Adams!
He's calling you, Pokey!
Mr. Adams!
What's the matter, Jimmy?
I can't keep up with you. I'm all in.
Hello there! Bring him in, Pokey!
Hold on. Now, what's the trouble?
I'm all in. Couldn't I ride on the sled?
All in? What's the matter with you?
I'm not used to hard traveling weather like this. I just can't take it like you can.
All right. We'll fix it so you won't have to travel. Let him have it, Bert.
Hey!
Knock him out with a single blow. Now to finish him off.
Hold on, Bert. He's out. That's enough.
Sure he's out, but let's finish him.
Don't be a fool. He won't last 2 hours in this weather. We beat him up for a shooter, and there'll be marks on him when his body's found.
I reckon you're right at that.
It'd be murder. And the mommies will start looking for the one who did it. Yeah, now, Bert, let's go through his clothes.
Okay. Yeah, his wallet.
Yeah, I'll take this ring off his finger.
How about this money in his pocket?
Yeah, bring it along. We'll turn it all over to his mother. Well, I guess that's about all there is.
And we better take his snowshoes off just in case he's not out as bad as we think.
No, leave him on. It'd look suspicious if he was found here without snowshoes. We want it to look like he got lost in the blizzard. Now, come on.
I'll handle the dogs for a couple of miles. Come on, you Malamute! Come on!
The first streak of gray dawn broke through the overcast as Sergeant Preston's team, drawing a light sled, pressed westward over the snow-packed trail to Halfway. The great dog King ran ahead as a free lead, his sensitive nostrils sniffing the wind that was now beginning to subside. For hours they'd been traveling without having found the faintest indication that anyone had passed over the trail. And then the big dog burrowed his nose into the drifting snow. Sergeant Preston watched him intently, knowing that some inner sense had told him that underneath the white blanket was the scent of humans who had passed over the trail.
Good boy, King. Don't lose it. On, you huskies! March! Hang on to it, King! Hang on, old boy!
Sergeant Preston knew that with the wind and storm diminishing, the trail was getting fresher, that the film of drifting snow had become thinner and the trail easier to follow. He pushed his dogs to keep up the increasing speed of his free lead, King.
On, King! On, you huskies!
Then he saw King pause and raise his head alertly. King's nostrils quivered as he sniffed the air. Suddenly, he dashed ahead, barking sharply. And then Sergeant Preston saw a dark object almost a quarter of a mile away, and he recognized it as a man. He saw the man staggering drunkenly, aimlessly. Then the Mountie saw him fall, face downward in the snow, to lie motionless. King raced toward the still form, followed by the Mountie in the sled. Kate Watson was cooking supper in the kitchen of the tavern at Halfway when she heard a scratching at the door. At first, she paid no attention to it. But the dogs of the village frequently came to her kitchen door for bits of food. Then the dog barked.
Sakes alive, that sounds like King. King, why, King, you old rascal, where'd you come from? Come on in here. Thought I recognized you, boy. Where's Sergeant Preston? Speaking. Trying to tell me. Now, what's the matter with you, King, holding your head up like that, huh? Oh, I see it now. There's something tied to your collar. Sure there is. Now, let me see it. Note. What in the world is this all about?
Kate Watson unfolded the note on the kitchen table, and in the soft light of the lamp read its contents. Then she turned to King, who sat watching intently.
King, thank you. Goodness for dogs like you and men like Sergeant Preston. Now, before I bust down crying, I'll feed you the biggest supper you ever ate. Then I'm going to have to keep you out of sight. I hope you'll understand it if I don't let you out of the kitchen. My boy. Come on, King. Come along, fella.
Kate fed King and put him out of sight, and then hurried through her own supper. It was nearly 10 o'clock when Big Steve Billows and his two henchmen, Pokey Adams and Bert Hogan, called at the tavern. Steve did most of the talking, using a voice that was filled with condolence.
You see, Kate, Pokey and Bert had been to Dawson to bank some money for me. They found your son on the trail as they were coming back here to Halfway.
And we'd have brought his body, but we didn't have room on our sled. We did the best we could for him, Mrs. Watson.
Are you sure it was Jimmy?
Show her what you brought along, boys.
Here, Mrs. Watson. We brought this wallet and ring and a little money he had in his pocket.
The wallet? That's his. And that's the ring I gave him when Walter and I came north.
It was Jimmy, all right. No doubt of it.
This country, this horrible country. First it took Walter away from me, and now it's taken Jimmy.
I don't blame you, Kate. I sure know how you feel.
If all that had happened to me, I'd want to clear out of the Yukon and stay on.
I wish I could leave here tomorrow and never lay eyes on the place again.
Hey, there's somebody coming in with a dog team.
One of you boys step out there and meet them. Tell them Kate's had trouble. They'd better put up at the other cafe for the night.
I'll tell them, Steve.
Go on, Pokey, close that door. It's cold.
Hey, Steve.
Yeah?
It's Sergeant Preston. And there's somebody strapped to a sled.
Preston, huh? I wonder why he's here.
Hey, I got bad news for you.
About Jimmy, Sergeant Preston?
Yes, Kate. About Jimmy.
I knew already.
Oh.
They've told me.
We just broke the news to her, Sergeant.
Now, me and Bert found him on the trail early this morning, but we didn't have space on the sled.
So we just brought along his wallet and bed.
I was going to send a dog team back for the body tonight, Sergeant.
You were, eh?
Sure. Just as soon as we broke the news to Kate. Say, boys.
Yes, Steve?
You and Bert go outside and get him. We'll help Kate lay him out.
Come on, Pokey.
Yeah.
Steve.
Yeah, Kate.
I reckon you'll stick to your promise now.
You mean our agreement?
Yes. I'll be needing money.
Oh, sure, Kate. Don't worry about that. I'll be around after the funeral and talk terms.
Steve, you've talked all the terms you're going to for a long time.
What do you mean by that, Preston?
I think you'll understand in a moment. All right, bring them in.
Get in there and take your hands off.
Hey, who's that?
It's a trick he was laying for us.
He got the drop on us.
Yeah, but who in thunder is he?
Hello, Mom. I'll give you a kiss when this is over.
Jimmy, my boy, Jimmy.
Jimmy, he's not dead.
Thanks to my dog, King, he's not.
Yeah, I get what you mean, Monty.
You're getting away.
When Big Steve tipped the table and his contents, Sergeant Preston was momentarily thrown off balance. Bert and Pokey leaped for the door in a desperate attempt to escape. But Sergeant Preston was upon them in an instant.
No, you don't. You can't keep me.
I'll help you, Sergeant.
Out of my way, kid. Get Bert.
That's where Steve's going, to the kitchen.
Get me.
Stop him.
The Mountie's fist dropped Bert. Another blow got Pokey. But Steve tried to escape in the opposite direction. He didn't know King was in the kitchen. King leaped at Steve, bowling the big man over with the force of his charge. King knew his business well. As Big Steve fell, the great dog leaped upon him, bearing strong fangs in readiness.
Come on, King. That does it, boys. Stand by, King. On guard. Keep an eye on those other two, Jimmy.
They've lost all interest in fighting.
Sir. On your feet, Steve. Now get over there with your pals.
That dog. I thought he'd kill me.
That's it. Let's keep close together so I can watch you.
Goodness, Jimmy, it looks like everything's all right.
Now, Mom, I'm going to give you that great big kiss I promised.
Jimmy, I'm so glad to see you, son.
She's a great little actress, don't you think, Sergeant Preston?
Never missed the cue, Jimmy.
Well, it was easy after King brought your note, Sergeant, telling me what had happened and how to carry out your plan.
You know, Mom, when the Sergeant told King where he was to go and what he was to do, I didn't have much faith in it. I didn't believe a dog had that much sense.
You just don't know, King. Why, Jimmy, that dog can do everything but talk. And I wouldn't be surprised any day if he walked in here and ordered bacon and eggs for breakfast. Sergeant Preston.
Yes, Kate.
Why would Steve Billows and them two crooks of his go to all that trouble to get a worthless mining claim?
It isn't worthless, Kate.
Well, it's not worth much. Leastways, my husband didn't think much of it.
Kate, did you ever hear of the Lost Indian Mine?
Why, yes. I've heard Indians and Eskimo talk about it, but I never put much stock in it. They say it was a mine a long time ago, but it got lost.
Yes, it did, when a mountaintop slid over it. Not long ago, I was sent up in the Salt Shaker Range to trace that old landslide. By tree markers and so forth, I discovered someone had been there ahead of me. And they were checking the same thing.
What'd you find, Sergeant?
Well, Jim, the claim your dad staked out was in the path of the landslide. And it's my guess that he'd found the lost Indian mine, but didn't know it.
You said somebody else discovered the same thing.
Yes, Big Steve Billows.
Why, that...
That's why he would resort to murder to get it. He knew if Jimmy were killed, you'd sell out cheap and go back to the States.
You dirty crook! Well, Sergeant, thanks to you and King, his plan didn't work.
I'll say they didn't. And another thing, Sergeant.
Yes, Jimmy?
I'm here to stay. I'm going to pick up where Dad left off with that mine, and Mom's going to have everything in the world she wants.
Jimmy.
From now on.
That's the spirit, Jimmy. The North needs men like you. And dogs like you, King. Thanks to you, old fella, and the trailing you did, the case is closed. These radio dramas are created and produced by George W. Trendle, directed by Fred Flowerday, and supervised by Charles D. Livingston. The part of Sergeant Preston is played by Paul Sutton. This is J. Michael wishing you goodbye, good luck, and good health. So long.